In this section, we discuss the major challenges in the production of thin film silicon solar cells. In the previous videos, we have discussed the use of surface roughness and the Stabler-Wronsky effect, which entails the light-induced degradation that afflicts amorphous silicon. In this video, we discuss a major challenge for creating high-efficiency multi-junction cells, namely current matching. The learning objectives for this video are therefore to understand what current matching is, why it is applied, and how current matching is achieved. We will look at the influence of certain material properties on current matching effectiveness. Finally, we'll look at silicon oxide, which is a versatile material that is used for, besides current matching, a number of applications in thin film solar cells. We see here a single junction amorphous silicon solar cell with flat interfaces. Amorphous silicon has a high defect density and consequently a short diffusion length. Furthermore, amorphous silicon suffers from light-induced degradation. The thickness of an amorphous silicon absorber layer is therefore limited to around 250 nanometers to establish high values for VOC and fill factor and stable external parameters. We saw in the previous video that introducing surface roughness increases the path length of light through the material without increasing the geometrical thicknesses of the absorber layer. A micromorph tandem cell is a multi-junction device with an amorphous silicon top cell and a microsilicon bottom cell. For one particular micromorph device, the current density produced by the amorphous top cell at the maximum power point is around 11.6 milliamp per square centimeters. Microcrystalline silicon has a significant lower density of metastable defects than amorphous silicon and does therefore not suffer from light-induced degradation. The microcrystalline absorber layer thickness is in practice limited to around 4 micrometers. In this particular micromorph device, the microcrystalline bottom layer produces about 15.8 milliamps per square centimeters. This visualized by the JV curves of the cells. The bottom microcrystalline cell has a much higher current at the maximum power point than the top amorphous cell. Reaching high efficiency with a multi-junction device requires each individual subcell to operate at the maximum power point. However, the current of the amorphous absorber limits the output of the tandem cell. If we transfer some of the current from the bottom to the top cell, so that both cells have matching output currents, the current of the tandem device will increase. Consequently, the conversion efficiency of the overall multi-junction device will increase as well. To achieve such a current transfer, an intermediate reflective layer or intermediate reflective layer, IRL, is used. An intermediate reflective layer is a thin layer placed between the top and bottom cell that reflects a fraction of the light back into the top cell. An intermediate reflective layer should have high transferred conductivity to allow charge carrier movement through the layer and should be highly transparent to incident light to minimize parasitic absorption. The refractive indices of amorphous and microcrystalline silicon vary from over 5 at a wavelength of 300 nanometers to just under 4 at a wavelength of 700 nanometers. Therefore, according to the Fresnel equations, the lower the refractive index of the intermediate refractive layer, the greater the reflectivity. But how exactly does the intermediate reflective layer affect the performance of the top and bottom cell? This figure shows the external quantum efficiency of both cells without an intermediate reflective layer. The external quantum efficiency, as you may recall, is the ratio of the number of incident photons to the number of collected electrons and is wavelength dependent. We can gather from this figure that the top cell operates in the high energy, low wavelength region. The bottom cell operates in the higher wavelength region. The top cell of this micromorph device produces 11.6 milliamps per square centimeters, while the bottom cell produces 15.8 milliamps per square centimeter. we now introduce an intermediate refractive layer with a refractive index of 2.05 at a wavelength of 600 nanometers. We can see that the EQE of the top cell is increased for wavelengths greater than 500 nanometers, as shorter wavelengths already absorbed in the first pass through the top cell. In the same wavelength range, the EQE of the bottom cell decreases. As a result, the current generated by the top cell is increased by 1.2 milliamps per square centimeter, while the bottom cell current is decreased by 1.5 milliamps per square centimeter. Naturally, the current transfer from the top to the bottom cell is not without loss, since some of the light is absorbed by the intermediate reflective layer. Furthermore, a fraction of the photons reflected back into the top cell has an energy above the microcrystalline silicon band gap, but below the amorphous silicon band gap. These photons would have been absorbed by the bottom cell, but are now transmitted from the front side of the cell. If the intermediate reflective layer has a refractive index of 1.95, yet more of the current is transferred from the bottom to the top cell. At a refractive index of 1.75, the top cell has a higher current output of 13.6 milliamps per square centimeter than the bottom cell at 13.2 milliamps per square centimeter. The optimal refractive index for this intermediate reflective layer is therefore somewhere between 1.75 and 1.95. Not only the refractive index of the intermediate reflective layer, but also the thickness of the intermediate reflective layer influences the current transfer. This is the EQE of a different micromorph solar cell, which has a top cell current of 11.1 milliamps per square centimeter and a bottom current cell of 13.7 milliamps per square centimeter without intermediate reflective layer. Now, an intermediate reflective layer is introduced with a refractive index of about 2.1 at 600 nanometers and a thickness of 40 nanometers. As the thickness of the intermediate reflective layer increases to 62 nanometers and 95 nanometers, the current transfer from the bottom to the top cell increases as well. Current matching between different cells in a multi-junction device does not only affect the output current of the device, as you will see in the next video.